thank you for having me. I'm honored to be here. And I'm going to ask the first question to Steve.
What are you going to ask me?
I'd like you to tell me your name and where you're from, then where you currently work.
Well, my name is Stephen Rowe, and I'm from Australia originally, and I live in Los Angeles, and that's where I currently work. Where do you work, Kristen Brin, from Montana?
Well, I'm a full-time successful artist, and I made my way here from Chicago, but I was born in St. Louis.
What is the primary medium in which you work, and why did you choose that medium?
I'm currently working on raw canvas. I'm pouring on it, and I chose acrylic because I get really excited and I can't wait for oil to dry in order to get back into what I'm doing. It's also, you know, less toxic. But for me, it's always been acrylic on canvas. It used to be primed, and now it's raw, and I really enjoy the thickness and the texture. And then I get to stretch it any size I want, and I like the big art.
When you say you put it on raw canvas, what do you mean? You've gessoed it, right? Or you've just stuck it on raw canvas?
Yeah, I don't gesso. I buy huge rolls of raw canvas, and I just leave it, and it absorbs and gives me this texture where it shows the grain. And primer keeps everything opaque. This gives me the opportunity to be translucent.
I get worried about raw canvas, actually, because that's what happened to the guy that I'm influenced by is Pollock, and he used painted on raw canvas. So what happens with that, it deteriorates in a certain amount of time if it's not taken care of. So maybe that's something to think about.
There are archival issues, but you can treat it post painting to lengthen its life. But it's also very important to use quality canvas. You don't want to grab something at Home Depot that's a carpenter canvas. You want to order fine art cotton canvas. And I'm looking forward to painting on linen soon. I'm going to change it up.
Oh, wow, linen.
That's
something that I don't think I'd ever want to approach, linen. When I paint, I mean, I love the acrylic because it's such a, it moves, it flows, and for me, I love it just how it dries so fast. And so with oil, I mean, I don't have the patience for waiting for that to dry, you know. So with the movement, you know, it all works for me, so yeah.
Well, I'm wondering how you change the viscosity of the paint you use so it really flows when you drip it.
You just got to know how
how
it feels and how it, you know, what consistency you want, you know, that you mix it to that.
Yes.
There's little tricks of the trade that that is always good to keep.
Indeed, that's why they're so then how did you become interested in fine art?
Well, as a young boy, I was always a drawer. I loved to draw, I loved to escape into the art world, and you know, metal class and woodwork class was one of my favorite things to do. And so, as a young boy, anything with the arts and working with my hands was something that was so important to me. And I needed something as a young boy. I mean, my mum left when I was about six. So it was, always like trying to find an escape to fulfill that happiness in my life. So that was one of the reasons why probably started to work with art.
Did you have the artistic freedom that you needed as a young person to go out and find things to paint on or glue together or whatever it was you're going to do? Didn't have that opportunity till you were older?
No, I never had that opportunity as a kid. I'm from a mining town in the outback of Australia, and growing up then was, you know, being an artist was not a choice. Making a living was the only way to go. So, you know, when I became a carpenter, that was the only way I could make my living. So Have you had any other career besides art? And if so, was it helpful to you in terms of what you do as an artist, or was it completely different and unrelated?
Well, I wouldn't call any other of the, you know, short-term jobs I have had in the past careers. So I'll say that I've had some work experience that helped me in my art career. One, for example, was I was a trade show model in Chicago over at McCormick, and I had to stand and meet and greet people all day long and get them into the booth. And now as an exhibitionist, that has really come in handy, you know, saying hello, greeting people, and getting them in to see what I have to show. And then I did have some retail sales, and I was also a waitress, shocking.
Oh.
Again, you know, greeting people, keeping them engaged, trying to sell as many courses as you can. But otherwise, you know, I've been an artist always. When I was young, my mom had to hide the scissors from me because I was always taking the scissors and the tape and whatever I could find, cardboard boxes, and making things and cutting them up and gluing together and ruining my sister's clothes. I didn't want to screw up my clothes, so I took my sister Sam's clothes. But I've always had artistic freedom in my family, and I was very lucky for that. I think they just wanted me to entertain myself, but nonetheless, it was a lucky thing for me. Are there other artists in your family?
Well, I mean, I was talking to someone about it the other day, and they said, was there any other artists? And I said, no, not really. I said, my dad was a carpenter. All my family were carpenters and builders, and they designed houses and built them. And then someone said, hang on a sec, that's an art, you know, yes, to be able to do that. So, you know, I figured that, so my dad was an artist in lots of ways.
I agree. That's an incredible art. And you're a fine Finnish carpenter.
So well, you know, with the other trades that I've done in my life, I started as a carpenter as a young boy. And then during that time, I raced motocross for Suzuki and was fully sponsored by them, yeah. And then during that time, I started around 15, 16, I started taking ballet class because my aunt needed extra kids for their show at the end of the year. So from that day on, I was so like overwhelmed by, this was really cool, like to be able to move with your body and be able to be on stage. And so that, you know, that's another reflection, I suppose, of a childhood looking for happiness somewhere and getting on stage and doing that. So I got into that, and then by the time I was 19, I went to a summer school in Adelaide in Australia, and they offered me a full-time scholarship. So I took that, and then I went on to be a classical ballet dancer for 17 years professionally. And then, you know, and then I during that time I was a singer-songwriter, I wrote songs and all that. And then I got into some acting, which was so much fun to do as well. And then I went back to my art. So during that time in the ballet world, I was also painting back then. 27 years now that I've been painting, but back then it was all part of the art. So everything that I've done in my life has all created where I am today with the arts, the music, the acting, the painting. So it's just part of that journey. So yeah, I've had a few trades, a few different jobs.
I love that you were in ballet, because I have a passion for ballet that's no end. And when I found out you were a professional dancer, I just was thrilled. It just, and people should know that sometimes when we see each other at the art show, I beg him to do a few little tombe, pas de rire, glissade, someplace with me.
Yeah.
And he indulges me. It's pretty funny.
Well, you know, I'm not going to continue to do that. Sorry.
That was going to be expected, because everyone's going to know.
But no, but that's where ballet comes into a lot of this artwork that I do behind me, you know, the movement and being on top of the piece, and that's done all on the ground. So all that movement is part of, like, chasse pas de bourrée, as you just said. It's all part of the process of laying this down on the canvas, you know. And for me, it's a great outlet. It's one of the best outlets that I've ever done. And this, you know, technique or the style of dripping art is something that's so it just makes me feel so exciting. You know, I feel so happy when I'm actually doing it.
That's one of the things that I love about your art, Stephen, is within the bounds of your asymmetry, because you're going bonkers on your canvas, you're always balanced. And there's symmetry and, you know, delight within all of this movement. When you really gaze at it, which I love to do, it's musical and beautiful, and, you know, while masculine.
Oh, thank you. Oh, I mean, it's that, you know, it's like, you know, we do large scale art, you know, and I mean, yours are very big and you know, creative and very minimalist. Well, of course, I love your work because I have a piece of your work on my wall.
Thank you.
That to me is something I love to do with other artists, actually. I love to trade out art. And I think it's important as artists to be able to do that, because if you really love their art and you're willing to put it on your wall, that's how I judge, would you put it on your wall as an artist? And if you like it, that's what I do. So, and a lot of in my house, I mean, this is just sitting up there at the moment, that doesn't actually go there. But so what I'm saying is, you know, I like other people's art, I collect other people's art, and it's important to have that in one's house, you know.
I remember when you approached me to trade, you know, we were next to each other at my first Beverly Hills Art Show, and you came up, and we'd been talking the whole week, but you came up at the end and you said, hey, do you want to trade? And I thought, he's going to give me one of his paintings? Yes, I want to trade. It was great. Thanks. I was honored.
No, that was, you know, that's like I said, it's something I like to do. So,
do you feel that your work has an overall subject or theme, and has it changed over time?
Well, yes, it does have a subject and a theme. I mean, all my work that I do in my different styles, it's all about happiness. That's my main goal, is to find that happiness. So when I find it, that makes me feel really, really excited. So, you know, sadness, there's sadness under a lot of my pieces. Like the piece behind you, you'll see a lot of darkness and red and the aggressive movements. But on top is light colors and happy. So that's almost like when you look at someone in life, underneath there's a sadness or there's a dark side of people, but on top you could all look happy and nice on the outside. So that's what a lot of that is all about, you know.
Very interesting. I did not know that. Let's see, I'll answer the same question.
Yes.
My subject matter is pretty consistent. I do love to paint landscapes and florals, but I am evolving into being less literal and obvious in the subject matter, which is a huge challenge, and I really like that. Then in 2013, I really fell in love with painting in white, layers of white, but not pastels, handsome colors married down with white paint. And for me, moving to Los Angeles and being in a blue sky, that was what I needed. And then I was recovering from an injury and an illness, and that was the dark for me. And I had to meditate about it and do yoga and try and figure out how I was going to keep myself from being dark. And the light paintings came. And people loved them. I love them. You can see they're all around my house. And that's a joyful thing for me, just like you. I'm happy. I want to show the happiness, the peace, and the tranquility that I live in. It reflects in my art.
Yeah, well, you know, of course, when I first saw your lighter art and the minimalist of it, it has so much emotion to it, actually. I mean, it has a lot of power to it just by the minimalist that it is. And that's why I've got a piece on my wall.
Thank you. Thank you. Minimalism is interesting. Some people come into my booth and say, I could do that. Isn't that sweet? But I took action and I did it. And that's why it's there. I find that amusing.
Well, it's like people always go past your booth and they always say that anyone can do throw paint on the canvas, you know, or do that. And that always, it puzzles me in lots of ways because I can't even do it from time to time. If I stop for a while, I find it very difficult to get back to where that movement is, because a lot of the movements, you know, there's a lot of people that put paint on canvas that can be very immature. There's an immature way of the paint landing on the canvas, and it really takes a lot to have that aspect of being able to lay it down again properly. I mean, going back to like Pollock, he in the end couldn't do his work, and he changed from his dripping style to an ink style on canvas. And almost figurative type stuff again, and people didn't want that. They wanted him to go back to the old style, that the dripping that he was doing. And then he tried to, and then if you see some of his works, they look awful. They just blended in together, but there you go, it's a Pollock, you know, what are you gonna do?
I agree with you about the disconnect. If I'm not in my studio connecting, working my particular stroke method or pouring, it takes me a while to get back into it. And that's a hard time, the disconnect. But once I'm back, every time I start to work, I think to myself, I love painting, I love painting.
I mean, it's really, you know, to get it back, it's tough. I mean, I get so frustrated to try and get it back. And, you know, to get some sort of balance in the pieces, to get some sort of feeling in the piece. And it can take a long time. I don't know how that works.
It does. And again, the task of not being literal with my color palette is a lovely challenge. But I do live on the beach. I do a lot of beach and water landscapes. And then I also live in the mountains. So I get to be influenced by that. And then you can grow anything in LA. So there are gardens and flowers everywhere. And anywhere I turn, I'm inspired. I like where I am right now.
Well, for me, I mean, yes. I mean, it's a lot of like colors from a gardens and flowers and all that sort of stuff. So I find these colors that I see in people's gardens. And that to me is something that I like to put on top. So I have pieces very similar to this that are called Monet's Garden. And the coloring of the lavenders and all that are in the pieces, so I'm very influenced by the landscape around, definitely. Let me ask this next one. Are you influenced by any other artist?
I have been, and now I try not to be. It's very important to be myself, and I'll say that I've committed to certain techniques that I love, like color field technique, which, you know, in the Rat Pack of Rothko and Helen Franken, I'm going to say it right, Frankendale, and Motherwell. I like that big, bulky section of soaked and stained canvas. And nowadays, everybody's on Instagram, and I try not to. I really am determined to be myself and not be influenced other than these historical artists that I admire.
You know, going back to Instagram that you say that, I see stuff on there that I go, wow, this is incredible, but it doesn't make me feel I want to try that sort of style because, you know, once you have been doing it for years and years, you start to feel, you know, you feel like you're creating something, you're creating your own style in a way, you know, your own feeling, your own style. So, you know, that is something that is important. But am I influenced by other artists? Yes, of course. I mean, you know, artists from my hometown in the outback of Australia, there was like five successful artists that made a living in my hometown. And one of them was, his name was Pro Hart, and he was a abstract artist. And he would do like bush landscapes, but he also got into really abstract type of stuff. And when I was a young boy, he sponsored me in racing motorbikes. He bought stuff for me and painted my helmet and all that sort of stuff. And then I'd go up there and work out at his gym. And his gym was this old rusted out gym I would work out on.
The bench press.
Yeah, just the old rusty. And his workshop would be in there. You know, he'd be painting, and I never paid attention to it. I never thought anything about it. You know, it's pro hard. But that was one of the biggest influences there with him painting while I was working out in that gym. And then I worked with another guy later on in life by the name of Lindsay Kemp. He was a choreographer, director, artist. And then that's when I came back from Europe, that's when I started really taking art again serious after working with him. So that was a really, really inspiring time. So of course him, and then Yayu Kusama with my other style that I do with dots. I do a lot of dots, so that was a big influence. And plus the Aboriginal art culture from where I'm from, that's actually influenced a lot of my other style. And then, I love Pollock. look, I could keep going on. The list goes on.
But, well, what about Len Aaron, our friend?
Our good old friend who just passed away, Len Aaron, who used to own Aaron Brothers. Yeah, no, of course, I was inspired by Len. I was inspired by Len in not just
painting,
in everything.
Yeah, he was an amazing person.
Well, for me, I mean, it's a lot of work. It's always a lot of work. And to try and market yourself, to get on the computer, to send out to places where that you can hopefully move your art, sell your art, it's a lot of work. It's a terribly lot of work. And people think it's just easy to pick up a paintbrush and start painting, and that's what art's all about. But there's so much that goes into your life and art career. It's just overwhelming how much work that there is behind it all. And for you, Kristen?
Well, I work every day, and I'm lucky that I have a slow and steady request for art from people who know me, commissions. I'm licensing with Restoration Hardware now. They have 5 paintings that they're doing as Cinegraph, which is a 3D print. But it's just slow and steady. I don't have the time. I have to paint. So it's, you know, I update my website and I work on Instagram. I wish I could afford to hire a publicist. And I go to the art shows, the big ones, and I mingle with the museum and gallery owners. And I just waiting for the absolute right fit in that department. But every day there are tasks and there's painting. I'm committed to being a professional, excellent, fine artist in 2013. That was my 100% commitment. And I looked around on juried art services and I thought, I want to start at the top. So I sought out, I applied, I prayed, I was accepted. And there I am in the luckiest outdoor art show in all of Los Angeles.
Well, I think, I've heard other people say that it's one of the best in the country. And I haven't gone out further too far. I've done stuff in, other art fairs. But I've just brought it back to just the Beverly Hills Art Show. That for me is the only one outside of fair that I do. When I started first doing it, I saw it over 12 years ago and I thought, oh, that, look at that fair. And I looked around and I thought, God, this is professionally done. Everything looks so well organized. And so I applied and thought, oh, I hope they take me. And they did, thank God for that. And then once I got in there, I realized all the people that organized it were so really, really fantastic people that put it all together. And
here,
I felt really comfortable. I felt really great about it. And now after 12 years, I've been there for 12 years now. So, and I'm going to continue to do it as long as I can. Plus Beverly Hills, I'm very honored that they have two of my pieces in their Beverly Hills collection. So I'm on to buy that.
He got the Mayor's Award.
Oh, well,
they selected two beautiful beautiful pieces.
It's an experience, and you know, it's something for us that we're not used to doing, and I'm not really the big talker about stuff, but it's hard. It's like pulling teeth for me, but I did it.
You did great.
You did. Awesome.
It was an honor. Thank you, Beverly Hills.